the first bank in South Dakota was the easy part, earning the confidence of local farmers, helping families account for their dreams, and securing the future for countless businesses took us a little longer. We owe it to the hard workers, big dreamers, and forward thinkers out there. Thank you for making South Dakota a great place to call home.
Hello and welcome to Sertoma Park in Yankton, South Dakota. I'm Zach Spear alongside Gage Ravelette as the Yankton Gazelles and the Rapid City Central Cobblers are set to match up here in more Class AA softball in the state of South Dakota. As we have got a windy one here today, the first pitch set for 5 o'clock. Hopefully the weather is going to work with us today. As you can probably hear in my microphone right now, the wind is blowing. We could see gusts as high as 45 miles per hour. And it's coming in from about left center field. So if you see anyone hit the ball over the fence, left or center field, just know they really got a hold of that one. But Gage, a beautiful day. Sun is shining. It's not really cold. It's just that wind.
Yeah, like you said, that wind is blowing straight into our face from home plate. If anyone hits a home run, that ball was going another football field. It's blowing just crazy. So, yeah, the weather's nice. Good day for baseball other than the wind gusts, I guess. And this music's getting me hype as I just sit here. So I can only imagine what it's like warming up.
And, you know, it's funny you mention that because I actually complimented them in the last game for the Gazelles. We had a lot of compliments in the crowd kind of saying, wow, they've got really good music here. And so I went and complimented them. And it's actually the Gazelles themselves are the one who pick out the music. And it was funny because there was some rap from like the 90s and stuff. So a lot of the parents were saying, oh, we're going a little old school here. And I found out it was actually the Yankton Gazelles who were picking out that music.
Yeah, I like some of the newer stuff. I can't lie, I do. I do like some of the newer stuff, but some of the older songs, you can't get away from them. They're just charms.
Well, hey, that's why we have Classic Hits 106.3 as a station. They're classics for a reason. So a little set the scene here. Yankton Gazelles and Rapid City Central, they both come into the game 0-3, both looking for that first win of the season. Rapid City doing the traveling, about a good five-hour drive, as I just talked with Coach Rodner of the Cobblers, as he said, yeah, it was about 5 hours. Felt like we made pretty good time. But either way, Yankton happy to be at home here, as they'll be home here today and tomorrow. And let's just take a quick look at the season they've both had. For Rapid City Central, they opened the season against Pierre TF Riggs. They lost 2-24. They then were at home against Watertown, 19-0 they lost. And as Rodner said, they kind of got their bats started there in that third game. Things started kind of coming along a little bit better than the first two. Against Aberdeen Central, they lost 21, but they put up 13. So an 8-run deficit, 13 runs, though, that will win you a lot of games. Now for the Yankton Gazelles, they opened the season traveling to Brandon Valley. They lost 4-7. They then had their first home game of the season against a very good Harrisburg Tigers team. They lost that one 18-1, and in their final one, just couldn't quite get the bats rolling against Sioux Falls Roosevelt, as a very good Hinch on the mound, a freshman pitcher for Sioux Falls Roosevelt, totaled 15 strikeouts through 7 innings on the mound, leaving only 6 total outs, Gage, that weren't strikeouts.
Yeah, and the bats weren't rolling, but the bigger number that I was more worried about was the 3 errors on the defensive side of the field. That pitcher for Yankton looked like she was just struggling out there on the mound, but a lot of them runs came from when there was 2 outs.
Yep.
A few of them errors were cleaned up. It's not an 8-0 game. It's going to be a 4-0 game, and it's a lot easier to get back into a game when it's 4-0 when instead it's the 7th inning and you're down by 8.
Exactly. So when we return, I did get a chance to speak with both head coaches ahead of this matchup, see their thoughts, but we will return in a moment after a word from our sponsors here on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
Make it a double. No, make it a triple. Triple Time Rudy's in Yankton. Stop for premium, ethanol, or regular gas anytime with pay at the pump. Or stop in during regular hours to find the meats, cheeses, beverages, snacks to fuel you up. There's oil, grease, and more for your vehicles, gift cards, an unbeatable staff, and just the right amount of that personal service. Make it a Triple Time Rudy's, corner of 17th and Broadway, Yankton.
Are you looking for a cool place to work? Look no further than Tuxedo. Not only does Tuxedo have a cool, positive, and people-oriented culture, but the building is climate controlled too. Check out the many job opportunities at Tuxedo. They're looking for a receiving supervisor, weekend production supervisor, weeknight shipping clerk, and weekday and weekend production positions. Apply at realtruck.com/careers. Tuxedo of Yankton. Working for a successful global business with customers in 140 countries. That's Vishay Intertechnology, a Fortune 1000 maker of electronic componentry. Now imagine a company of that size with that kind of stability and a caring family-like environment. Learn more about what you can do at Vishay by visiting VishayCareers.com. Vishay is an equal opportunity employer. Vishay, the DNA of tech.
Simple sniffles to complex health conditions, the primary care providers at Yankton Medical Clinic will not only see you for your annual visits, screenings, and preventative care, but also provides care for the entire family, from pediatrics to adults. With 4 clinic locations and 15 outreach locations throughout South Dakota and Nebraska, compassionate, quality medical care is closer than you think. For more information on providers, services, and locations, visit our website, yanktonmedicalclinic.com.
Yankton Rexall, located in the Meridian District, downtown Yankton, has Hallmark cards and keepsake ornaments. They carry many different items for that wedding, anniversary, or special birthday, along with collectibles like Precious Moments and Willow Tree. The pharmacy is home to the ever-popular Med Packs, and the toy store offers Melissa and Doug toys, Abdallah chocolates, and Sweet Shop candy. When you want something perfect for gift giving, find it at Yankton Rexall in the Meridian District on 3rd Street.
The wait when your furnace and AC needs repair by joining Larry's Heating and Cooling Comfort Care and Elite Care Club. Larry's Comfort Care Club features seasonal maintenance discounts on service and no overtime charges. Larry's Elite Club includes seasonal maintenance, free parts, free labor, free service calls, and both mean you are in front of the line for service. Call Larry's Heating and Cooling and sign up for the Comfort Care or Elite Care Club. Larry's Heating and Cooling, Yankton and Vermilion.
Welcome to our Coaches Conversations. Right now I'm chatting with head coach Zane Rodner of the Rapid City Central Cobblers. Coach, how are you doing today?
I'm doing good. Doing really good.
Good to hear. And the first long road trip of the season for you and your team, as you've got to make the trip to Yankton. What are both some of the goods and bads of having such a long drive?
Well, the good is that you just get a lot of time to think, and the bad is that you also get a lot of time to think. So it's what we West River folk have to deal with whenever we travel to different schools. So it's something that you just try to make the most out of.
And could you tell us about your season so far?
Well, we're 3 games in. Our first weekend of games was this last weekend, and we saw some good things, and we saw a few things that we definitely need to work on. But it's just nice to be able to get on the field and compete and see how we stack up against other teams.
And like you said, nice to just get out on the field. I know pretty much every team in the state has been dealing with some postponements of their earlier games as well. Has that been a big factor out west for you as well?
It has been, and it's just something that we as where we live, we have to deal with on a regular basis, especially in the spring. Like today, it's 50 degrees and sunny, but it's supposed to be blowing about 50 miles per hour out here. And come Friday, when we are on the road and out of town, it's supposed to be 80 degrees. So
yeah,
it's just something that we have to realize that we have to make the best out of.
And so what are some of the things that you've seen your team do well so far?
Offensively, especially this last weekend, was our strong point. We put a lot of balls in play, and that was kind of what I was anticipating going into the weekend, just because that is definitely what we've been working on the most, especially when we have to be inside in the cages and that sort of stuff. It was definitely our strong point, seeing our defense and our pitching We knew there was going to be a few hiccups, a few mistakes here and there going into the weekend, but throughout the weekend, we definitely were stronger defensively, and the more strikes that we throw, our pitchers throw, is only going to help us out defensively in the long run.
And now, who are some of the players on your team that we should be expecting to make big plays in this game?
Like our three seniors that we have, they're all three strong. Mary Kohlhoff, Cheyenne Dudley, and Jalen Elias. Cheyenne will be, they're all infielders. They're all going to see time in the infield. Cheyenne will probably pitch a little bit. And they're all three strong players. They're great attitudes. They give it their all in the field, offensively and defensively, and they really are leaders when it comes down to it.
And so that leads right into my next question. I was going to say, I see that you only have three seniors on the team. You've got a lot younger of a team than a lot that we do see. Did any of the freshmen or the eighth grader on your team get varsity playing time last year?
The freshman, we did have an eighth grader last year on our team, and she is pretty much our starting fielder right now. We're going to have probably two or three, if not four, freshmen on the field this weekend, probably starting. And so, yes, we are a young team overall. But like I say, those three seniors that we have, they're not the most vocal leaders, all three of them, but they definitely lead by example and push the younger girls to work hard and get better.
And so coming up now, you take on the Gazelles. What are some of your thoughts on this matchup?
Well, it's just another opportunity to be on the field and compete. I really don't look into stats, especially when it comes to opponents, because the main thing is I want us to get better from weekend to weekend, hopefully preparing ourselves for that May 21st Sweet 16 play-in game. And so as long as we do what we're supposed to be doing on the field, competing and, like I say, progressing from week to week, that's my ultimate goal when it comes down to, doesn't matter who we're playing. So that's the main thing I want to see coming this week and being in Yankton and Sioux Falls, is that we just see that progression from the previous week.
Well, Coach, thank you so much for taking time out of your day to talk with me, and we'll see you at the game. Good luck.
Hey, thank you.
Again, that was Zane Rodner, head coach of the Rapid City Central Cobblers. We'll be back in just a moment to talk with Gazelles Coach Muth in a moment on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
Nice.
Maytag appreciates a compliment, but this Maytag washer isn't just eye candy.
Wow.
Inside, it's got the capacity and power to handle even the mightiest loads.
I love this.
Yeah, she's a beaut.
It's a he.
How do you know?
Don't worry about it.
Find Maytag products and the industry's best appliances at your local dealer, Murph's Appliance, downtown Vermilion.
Your invitation to thrive in Yankton, South Dakota. Nestled on the bluffs of the Missouri River, plenty of outdoor adventures are waiting. Whether you work remote or in a traditional office, we have a spot for you. Quality healthcare, diverse manufacturing, progressive school system, Mount Marty University, and so much more. Explore with family and friends. Let's thrive together.
TNRC Smith Insurance has been a part of the Yankton community since 1949. Our agency would love to help you with your home, auto, business, life, and long-term care insurance needs.
We take pride in providing you with quality service when you have a claim or need to make changes to your coverage.
The MT and RC Smith Insurance Agency is flexible to meet with you in person or at the office at 204 West 4th Street. Give them a call for insurance changes, payments, claims, or service requests.
Continually strive to improve the quality of service we provide the Yankton community, the Garden of Memories Cemetery and Winston Ray Funeral Home are pleased to announce the completion of a brand new columbarium. This columbarium is constructed of granite, designed to withstand the test of time. It is for those families choosing cremation and features above ground outdoor niches, which includes a bronze plaque to memorialize your loved one, as well as indoor glass front niches where families can create a unique memorial with pictures or other family heirlooms. For more information, please give us a call at the Winston Ray Funeral Home in Yankton.
Welcome back to our coaches' conversations. Now on the line, it's head coach Jill Muth of the Yankton Gazelles. Well, when the season starts, it really starts, right?
Yep. No rest for the wicked here. I mean, game here, kind of really fast.
And after having a few game days in a row last week, and then into the beginning of this week, you had two practices. Now you have three games between today and tomorrow. Is the team ready for that?
Well, I hope so. We spent, quite a bit of time trying to get some swings on live pitching, and we worked on some defensive stuff. I think those were kind of the two keys that we wanted to look at taking care of. So we'll see how it goes today.
And so you said you did get a chance to have some swings at some live action pitches. Did you see some improvement for some players? Did you see it really help them a lot?
Well, I shouldn't say live pitching. I should say we used the pitching machine. So we got out our pitching machine and used that. But, yeah, I think we had some kids get some good swings on there. So hopefully the bats will be a little better today. We'll see. The wind is blowing pretty hard, so I don't know what that's going to do to pitches, if that's going to push them all over the place or what's going to go on.
And the wind definitely going to be some sort of a factor, whether it's fly balls going a little further than maybe they should or trouble in the outfield. But that's part of outside sports here in South Dakota.
Yep, absolutely. Just from looking out the window, I think it's blowing in. So that's going to, make it a little bit harder on our outfielders and happen to make sure that they're playing in the right spot and get themselves to a ball. And probably everybody will be playing in a few steps, and we'll see what happens.
Right. So if somebody hits a home run, they really got a hold of that one.
I would say it would be pretty impressive if somebody gets one out of there today.
So first on your list of those three games, it's Rapid City Central. They're traveling to East River for a couple games. What are you hoping to see your team do in this game?
I just hope we, can compete. We want to come out and throw good pitches, make good plays on the defensive end, and then have good at-bats. Swinging at good pitches, making solid contact, and make them make the plays.
And, of course, as I mentioned, you have multiple games. It's only over the course of today and tomorrow. What is the plan with pitching? How does that affect it? Do you plan on Hanson and Gerard switching back and forth? Is there a chance of a third pitcher taking to the mound?
No, I don't think at this point we're looking at a third pitcher. I think it's going to be Hanson and Gerard.
Okay, so we'll see. Hopefully, so far they've shown that they can. Hanson specifically, as she's been on the mound to start each game, has shown she can go the distance.
Yeah, she's done a pretty nice job for us, throwing strikes, and sometimes they hit it, but, she's done a nice job of trying to keep people off the base by, not walking too many drills, so that's all we can ask of her.
And sometimes it is just a matter of getting that first one. How important would it be for you and this team to come away with a win, and what kind of momentum would that give you heading into tomorrow as well?
Yeah, absolutely. We're obviously 0-3 on the season, and getting that first win would be nice. Just getting that monkey off our back of, okay, now we're okay, now let's keep going, Now we can go from here. Now it's not, oh my gosh, we need to win, oh my gosh, we need to win. Now we can just go play.
And it does take off the pressure, as it's just like being in an inning where they score a few runs and you don't get that out. You just need to get the first one, and then you can kind of see that snowball effect where they start rolling on.
Yep, absolutely. You're exactly right.
Well, thank you, Coach, for the chat. We will see you in a bit for Gazelle Softball.
All right. Thanks, Zach. Appreciate your coverage.
Again, that was Jill Muth, head coach of the Yankton Gazelles. We'll be back in a moment for the matchup between Rapid City Central and Yankton in a moment on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
And there you just heard from head coach Jill Muth of the Gazelles, as well as before that was Zane Rodner of the Cobblers. And Yankton, again, they may be 0-3, but this team definitely has potential. They just got to get those bats moving, as Jill Muth had talked about. And they did get a little bit more opportunity here to see actual, wasn't live pitching, as Muth said. It wasn't live, but it was off of the pitching machine. A lot better than, say, when you're tossing it up in the batting cage, going through your routines, drills. And those are good. They serve their purpose as well. But really, nothing's going to beat the actual experience of standing at home plate and swinging against pitches coming in right around that speed that, you know, you should expect from the mound. So we'll see if Yankton is able to capitalize off of those practices they were able to get or not. And we did get a chance to get both of our starting lineups ahead of time. As usually here in Sertoma Park, things do get going a little bit early, so time for your starting lineups. We'll get them through here. Rapid City Central Cobblers leading off is number 9 in center field. It's Lily Larson. She's followed by number 2 at the number 2 position, catcher Mary Kohlhoff. In the 3 slot, shortstop number 13, it's Cheyenne Dudley. And in the cleanup spot for the Cobblers, shortstop number 13, left fielder number 11 was looking up one, Shayna Weir. In the 5 spot, another power hitter for the team, number 12, second baseman Jalen Elias. She's followed by Haley Lang, who'll be in right field wearing number 23. Batting 7th for the Cobblers, also on the mound, it's number 18, Braylon Brown. She's followed by number 16 at third base, Malia Saucerman. To round up the Cobblers lineup is number 15, first baseman Katie Crandall. Cobblers are coached by Zane Rodner. Assistant coaches Lindsay Gibbons. And the reserves are number 14, Addison Prudich. Number 10, Lily Torres. Number 21, Andrew Borman. Number 8, Lexi Utech. Number 29, Kaylee McCollum. And number 33, Savannah Sakau. Now for your Yankton Gazelles, coached by Jill Muth. Leading off center fielder, number 17, Emma Iacker. Number 20, left fielder, Cameron Koletsky in the 2 spot. In the 3 spot, shortstop, number 21, Kyra Churchma. And in the 4 spot, the catcher, number 23, Peyton Mosier. Batting 5th, number 24, first baseman, Emma Herbelt. She's followed by number 11, third baseman, Madison Gerard. At second, wearing number 2, Jocelyn Burns. And in the 8 spot, McKenna Hatchesky, wearing number 18 as the designated hitter for the pitcher, Tori Hansen. And rounding up the Gazelles lineup is number 12, right fielder Haley Schulte, reserves for the Gazelles. Number 1, Madison Musfeld. Number 4, Elena Nelson. Number 13, Chase Drotzman. Number 25, Haley Bottleson. And number 26, Eliza Gurney. Again, first pitch is set for 5 o'clock here, as we'll be back in a moment. We'll have our national anthem and then the first pitch here at Sertoma Park. It's all on 5-star streaming on YouTube.
Know what to do. Ever since my neighbor grew in, he just keeps pushing.
Move over! Y'all in my way! Hey, where do you keep the snacks around here? Hey, put me down!
So long, loudmouth.
2 is company, but 3's a crowd.
Wisdom teeth mouthing off? Sounds like a job for Siouxland Oral Surgery. We're the oral surgery specialists with the tools and training to deliver better diagnoses, greater safety, and better outcomes.
There's a whole new world out there. It's called the off-road, and it's waiting to be explored in a Polaris. So gear up to make every moment count with the Polaris off-road vehicle. The new Polaris 2024 models are in at Stockman's Motorsports in Yankton. Get ready to tackle the trails this winter. With machines like these, your world just gets bigger. Stop in at Stockman's Motorsports today to learn more about the epic new Polaris off-road lineup.
AR's Oasis in Yankton, your one-stop store for everything you need. The parking lot, it's the biggest in town for ease of getting in and out. Oh, and the selection they have inside, it's unbeatable. Energy drinks, coffee, pop, and even something for the adults. Now the food selection, they only give me 30 seconds, but there's daily specials posted right on the outside, along with burgers, ribs, and so much more. JR's Oasis, Highway 50 East, Yankton.
Piper, the sign says it all, flowers and gifts. The store is bustling with something new all the time. There are flowers for any occasion, weddings, anniversary, birthday, or just to say I love you. There's coffee, soups, dips, and sweets. Need to give someone a chuckle? The socks say it all. Home decor, candles, jewelry, memorial items are all found at your gift store of Pied Piper Flowers and Gifts, corner of 15th and Broadway in Yankton. You can also shop online, and best of all, we deliver too.
From sunup to sundown, the work ethic of the farmer is unquestioned. As farming methods change and evolve, you need a financial partner to help you reach your goals. Elkhorn Valley Bank's experienced lenders are committed to providing dependable advice and fast local decisions, no matter the size of the operation. From farmland to livestock, you can count on us today and in the future. Elkhorn Valley Bank and Trust. There really is a difference.
Here on the field, just finishing up the starting lineups for both teams as they're lined up. For the Cobblers, wearing red with white pants, and Gazelles in white jerseys, black pants, as here's the playing of the national anthem. As you heard it, let's play ball. Just about underway. First pitch again set for 5 o'clock. It'll be awfully close to 5 when the first pitch takes place. Rapid City Central to bat first as they had to make the 5-hour journey here to Yankton at Sertoma Park. Again, I'm Zach Spear alongside Gage Ravelette on 5-star streaming on YouTube, home of Yankton Gazelles softball. All Yankton athletics are brought to you by First Dakota National Bank of Yankton. Now, leading off for the Cobblers will be Lily Larson. She'll take on Tori Hansen, who will be on the mound for the Gazelles, as the Gazelles have officially taken to the field. Again, Yankton wearing their home white jerseys with black pants, red letters and numbers on the jerseys. For the Cobblers in red jerseys, white pants with white numbers, white letters. Peyton Mosier heading back to take place behind the plate, take a few warm-ups here from Tori Hansen. And again, we'll see how the wind affects this game, because it has been blowing pretty much directly from left center field. But both teams looking for their first win of the season. They both come into this game at 0-3, as we should be in for a good one. And as we talked with Muth, just getting that first one sometimes can be the toughest part. Just need to get one to get over that hump. Then you can play a little bit more relaxed, not worry so much about getting, you know, now it's, oh, we got to win, we got to get that first one. After you get that first one, you can relax. We got it, no problem. So we'll see, you know, how both these teams come out. As Lily Larson will step into the batter's box facing Hansen, as this game officially underway. The first pitch brought to you by the Move Group, Mason Schramm in the Move Group. Girard picks it up at third, a grounder scooped up and out number one. One pitch, one out here at Sertoma Park. As Girard has been very solid on third base so far this season.
Yeah, that's probably the best way to start a baseball game, if you ask me.
Yeah, one pitch, one out, efficient. Don't force your pitcher to throw too many, as Hansen's next pitch is in for strike one. So with an out, no runners on here, it's Mary Kohlhoff at the plate. On deck, Cheyenne Dudley. Kohlhoff, no swing on that first pitch. Takes a called strike two as well. Now the count 0-2. As Hansen on the mound, only three pitches, but three strikes thrown. A good sign here early for Yankton. Hansen winds up. As that one's a grounder hit to shortstop. Picked up. Churchma makes the throw out number two. So two up, two down here for Rapid City Central. They're making contact, but they're hitting right into the fielders. Soft grounders. You know, pretty easy fielding here so far for Yankton.
Yeah, two quick routine plays by infield. Can't get much easier than that.
So Churchma and Gerard both making a play on defense. Hansen throwing nothing but strikes so far to start this one. Two outs, no runners on, as not sure, some kind of discussion. But Cheyenne Dudley at the plate. On deck is Shayna Weir. As Dudley over to Gerard. Gerard gets out number three. Three up, three down. I don't think we even saw six pitches gauge. That's three outs. Yankton Gazelles heading in to bat.
Yeah, we're here on a roll. Looks like we're starting off on a roll.
So Madison Gerard with two of them, Churchma with one. We'll be back in a moment where Emma Iacker is set to start things off for the Gazelles.
Seasons Power Sports in Yankton can help make your life easier and more fun. All Seasons Power Sports can help you with ATVs, side-by-sides, fishing and pleasure boats, as well as motorcycles, watercraft, and more. Check out their inventory at AllSeasonsPowerSportsInc.com. All Seasons Power Sports, your authorized Honda and Yamaha dealer, on your way to the lake in Yankton.
At Avera, we believe good health starts early, and that good health care can inspire a life of wellness. At Avera, we believe in push-ups and pumping iron. We believe less is more, and live for apple slices instead of apple pie. At Avera, we live for staying healthy and enjoying the little things. We're invested in healthy living so you can live longer.
Top of the first inning already put away within a matter of maybe 3 minutes, as five pitches from Hansen, all strikes, three ground outs for the Cobblers starting lineup there. Again, it's Emma Iacker who leads off at the plate. She faces Braylon Brown, will be on the mound for the Cobblers. Behind home plate for Rapid City Central is Mary Kohlhoff. That's the battery that Rapid City Central going with. Of course, for the Gazelles, it's Tori Hansen and Peyton Mosier, as it has been all year. Wind kind of gusting, picking up here, and you know, you get moments where there's not really anything, and then the next thing you know, we're worried about our camera falling over.
Yeah, I almost want to leave and go play around a golf for a while, and then that big wind gust comes back, and I realize I'm just fine where I'm at.
Right, it's like, oh, maybe after this I can go golfing. Maybe I can. It'll make my drive look a lot nicer if I'm hitting with it.
That's true. I'm only going to play about half the holes.
So Emma Iacker here for the first time of the game. Looking to start here with a runner are the Gazelles against Braylon Brown. We'll see what she's got on the mound. Brown winds up, fires it. Iacker got a good piece of that one. The line drive fouled out of play, though, the left field line.
That looks like that fan almost snagged that with one hand.
And, you know, hey, that's one of the things I always kind of hope a ball comes here. I've caught a ball, I think, twice while broadcasting. So I'm hoping to get the big number three, but directly behind home might be a little bit more difficult.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to get any free popsicles today, Zach.
Iacker takes the second strike. 0-2 now the count. Brown up. Looking accurate so far. We've seen two pitches from her. Iacker made contact on the first one, looking to do so again. That pitch well low for ball one, and kind of the pitch you sometimes expect when a pitcher's up 0-2. They're going to try something, try and get you swinging. It's usually not a very good pitch.
No, yeah, if you're up 0-2 in the count as a pitcher, you definitely throw one outside the box. Get them a little jumpy, a little scared. Maybe not in the dirt, though.
So the next pitch, Iacker takes that two right above her left knee, looked like. So she's standing on first, but a base runner nonetheless here for the Gazelles. Cameron Koletsky at the plate now. On deck is Kyra Churchma. Kaletsky, with one base hit on the season, trying to make it two here, was a double against Brandon Valley. That pitch is high. Iacker is taken off for a second. The throw down to second makes it in time, though. Iacker is going to be thrown out.
Good throw and tag.
And that was a nice play. Mary Kohlhoff had that throw well in time. Catch was made by shortstop Cheyenne Dudley, or was it the second baseman, Jalen Elias, I think so.
It looked to be the shortstop to me.
Was, okay. Cheyenne Dudley then with the tag out. Kaletsky gets a piece of that one, a grounder hit to the third baseman as it's bobbled, an error. Cameron Kaletsky now standing on first, another on base here for the Gazelles. That'll be an error. But Kaletsky just happened to be on for her team here. Churchma at the plate. Mosier on deck. Mosier able to take off that catching gear now. After it's barring a double play, she will see an at-bat here in the first inning. Brown's pitch low and inside, ball one. So Braylon Brown threw a couple of strikes right away, beamed Iacker. Kaletsky on the first one. No swing. Iacker got thrown out, but hit the second pitch. That one well high. 2-0.
Are you going to go for another steal on second if you're the coach?
You know, Gage, I think it makes me think twice after watching Kohlhoff throw out my leadoff batter. I think I sit still on first for now, see what happens and what Churchma can do. She's a very capable hitter at the plate, and now she's up 3-0 in the count.
Yeah, this is a no-swing position, unless it's right down the pipe going 5 miles an hour, maybe. That's the only way you're getting me to swing.
Yeah, as a lot of batters do get the take signal when it's a 3-0 count. We'll see if Churchma has it as well. Fourth pitch of this at-bat is high. Churchma's headed to first. Two base runners here for the Gazelles. Kaletsky on second, Churchma on first after the walk. Peyton Mosier at the plate with Emma Herbold on deck. And so no base hits through the first three for the Gazelles, but they do have three on base. So really, doesn't really matter that you don't have any base hits anyway on.
The big difference between this game and the last one is they are making contact with the ball this time. They aren't getting struck out. I mean, they're hitting some foul balls. And I mean, you got hit by a pitch, so that didn't really give you the opportunity to get a hit. And another one was an error. So, I mean, you're making contact with the ball, so it is improvement from last game.
Put the ball in play, good things happen. That pitch high. Mosier no swing, 2-0 now the count. So if Mosier gets on, that would lead bases loaded for Emma Herbold, who is on deck. Madison Girard in the hole. We'll see if she gets an at-bat here in the bottom of the first inning. But Mosier still waiting for something to swing at. As that one looked like the umpire shook his head. No, he did. Just missed inside. Three balls, no strikes here. As you got to imagine, after seven balls here, Mosier probably getting the hold sign. One down, runners on first and second. The 3-0 pitch also misses inside. Peyton Mosier heads to first. As she's walked, Churchma to second, Kaletsky now on third. Herbold's got bases loaded and only one out. This is almost the best situation you can be in, because as long as you get hold of it, even if it's caught in the outfield, more likely than not, you're scoring a runner from third, unless it's shallow into left field. But, you know, as a hitter when I was in baseball, nothing better. Bases loaded.
Yeah. If you're a batter here in the five spot, bases loaded, all you got to do is put the ball in the outfield. It doesn't matter if you get out, your team's scoring a run if you do. So, yeah, if I'm the batter, I'm swinging for the fences every time. And if I make contact, at least I'm getting an RBI.
Well, I don't know about swinging for the fences every time, Gage, but we'll see how Herbold at the plate decides to take the approach. Girard now on deck. Burns in the hole. As that pitch low and inside, Kaletsky takes off for home. The Gazelles have scored the first run of the game. Koletsky scores. Churchman to third. Mosier to second. Now the count, 1-0. So Yankton, really the kind of start that they needed here in this one. As you wonder how much that wind is affecting, too, the pitching on the mound. Brown, that one looked good, and it is. One ball, one strike here for Herbolt. And now after scoring that run, it does take a little pressure off the batter as well. You know, with no runs on, you're thinking, okay, we've got to score one here. Obviously, your goal is to get another one, but does take some of that pressure off. Braylon Brown, that pitch high, ball two. So two balls, one strike, one out here. Runners on second and third for the Gazelles. Churchman on third with Mosier on second. At the plate is Emma Herbolt. Madison Girard on deck. Gazelles trying to put up more than that one they got. That pitch got away from Brown. High and outside. 3-1 now the count. So no matter what, though, here in the first inning, Yankton will have the lead heading into the second. We'll see, though, if the Cobbler's able to minimize the damage done here. Braylon Brown looks to get back on track on the mound. That pitch is low, and that'll put Herbolt on first with a walk. The third straight here for the Gazelles as Madison Girard now with one out, bases loaded. As Girard already a couple of plays over at third. We'll see if she can keep up the good play here at the plate as well. She's batting 285 here on the season as a junior for Yankton. She's going to take the first pitch. She's hit by it. Another score crosses for Yankton. Churchman crosses home. Mosier to third. Herbolt to second. Madison Girard now on first. Jocelyn Burns here now, her first at bat here, and I believe her first start of the season. Her and Chase Drotzman have kind of flipped at second base a couple of the games, and batting as well, but Burns has bases loaded. Gazelles now have scored two runs. Brown, first pitch is high, no swing from Burns, it's called for a ball. So the Cobblers trying to get back to their dugout to bat here. Burns currently at the plate with McKenna Hatchiski on deck, hitting in place of Tori Hansen, the pitcher. Burns got a piece of that one, fouled it straight back into the net. 1-1's your count. So still with only one out here, Yankton has to feel good about how this inning has went for them so far after the three up, three down in the field. Scoring a couple runs here at the plate with chance at more. Brown's pitch is high. Ball two.
Keep up there.
You're all right. We'll see. Burns here. Still no base hits here in the game for either side. As that one, did it get a piece of Burns? It didn't, but it was low and inside. Ball three here, 3-1 now the count. Thought it maybe got her foot, must not have. Must have went right under as she lifted. What'd you see, Gage?
You know, I thought it hit her foot, but I think the sound I heard from hitting her foot was just a pad. I think my listening time was a little bit off there, but didn't get a really good angle. The catcher kind of covered it up from me.
3-1, Jocelyn Burns takes a swing. It's fouled off. Now count full. Braylon Brown here with the chance to get one of the needed two outs here by herself.
Yeah, one more strike at least can really turn this around. Just confidence right now, I think, is a big issue. If she throws a few more strikes, gets that confidence back, I think the Cobblers can really turn things around and stay in this game.
Yeah, and that's really, they need to get an out here with a 3-2 count. Though, as that one's low, it'll score another run here for Yankton. Mosier crosses home plate, Herbold to third. Gerard now standing on second with Burns at first. With the walk, she did have a full count. Timeout called here as head coach Zane Rodner wants to talk with his team. We'll take that timeout with him. It's a Lindsay Echo Water Systems of Yankton timeout. We'll be back in a moment.
At Elwood Family Dental Care, we treat our patients like family. We have an experienced and caring dental team. We take the time to make sure you understand your oral health and answer any questions you have about your dental treatments. We take pride in educating our patients. Whether you need fillings, crowns or bridges, dental implants, just a teeth cleaning, or even Botox, come visit us at 1818 Broadway Avenue. And remember, we take care of the entire family.
As you hear the organ playing, now we don't actually have an organ player in Yankton, but sure sounds like we do have one. lots of sound effects here at Sertoma Park. And walk-up music for the Gazelles as McKenna Hatchesky, her first at-bat in the game. She also has bases loaded. Still one out here. No base hits, though. As Braylon, the next pitch, misses inside.
No, I thought that one was a strike.
Yeah, that was a close one. And of course, you know, we are at a little bit of an angle. I always like to give the umpire a little benefit of the doubt type of deal. Because, you know, we are at a little bit of an angle. Sometimes the outside, inside, what we can tell really well, height, but maybe not inside, outside, is Hatchesky takes that one, hits the inside zone.
Yeah, I guess he probably knows a little bit more about baseball and softball than I do. So,
1-1 the count, one out. Haley Schulte on deck. She'll be the lone lefty in the lineup for the Gazelles today. Brown, the pitch, Hatchesky got a piece, a dribbler back to Brown. Gazelles are going to score one. But it didn't appear that Katie Crandall was standing on first there. That's going to count as an error, Gage. So Gazelles score again. Herbold crosses home. Gerard to third. Jocelyn Burns at second. McKenna Hatchesky on first with an error. Haley Schulte now batting.
Yeah, it looked like they still could have got her out on first, but like you said, the first baseman stepped off the bag, which allowed the runner getting there safely. But
yeah, Hatchesky, I mean, they could have had an opportunity, but either way, base is still loaded, one out here. Haley Schulte took the first pitch. It is a ball, 1-0 the count. Gazelles lead 4-0 on our Fox Stop scoreboard. As that pitch low and away, 2-0 now. Iacher on deck here. She led off for the game for the Gazelles. Has an opportunity to bat two times here, and she will unless there's a double play. And Schulte at the plate, again facing a 2-0 count here. That pitch, another ball inside, 3-0. Three balls, no strikes, one out here. Schulte will see if she has the take sign as well. Braylon Brown winds up, fires it. That's in for a strike. Looked good the whole way through. Schulte now facing a 3-1 count. We'll see. You know, if you see that pitch again, more likely than not, she's probably swinging than with the 3-0 count. As that one looked good from Braylon. She tries to replicate it. And she will. Strike two. Count now full.
Little bit of pressure.
It is. And Schulte maybe thought that was ball four. Kind of started her trot. We saw a couple times in the last game where the Gazelles thought they were walked, tossed the bat and had to go get it. And not quite that far. But Schulte thought maybe, you know, standing on first. Either way, full count here. One out. as Schulte fouls that one off out of play. Now with with the sun shining over there, I can't even tell you where that landed.
Yeah, that one went straight in the sun for me.
And it's a good thing that really none of the players outside of possibly Kohlhoff behind home plate really have to look into the sun, and that's just well designed on the field.
Yeah, sun's pretty much out of play for everything. So
Schulte gets walked. She's headed to first. Another score crosses for the Gazelles. Madison Girard scored. Jocelyn Burns at third. Emma Eicher now at the plate with Hatcheski on second. Schulte on first with a walk. Her second at bat of the game already in here in the first inning. Eicher, her team up 5-0 here. Only one out. No base hits, though, still by the Gazelles in this one. Eicher got a piece of that one, fouled it, 0-1 the count.
Yeah, we've seen quite a few bats on ball, so it's kind of weird to think there's been zero hits so far.
It really is, because like you said, the ball has been put into play a few times. We've seen errors, though, walks, beans, about everything else. But a base hit here in the game as Eicher, for the second time of the game, is going to be beaned, scoring another run for the Gazelles. Burns will cross home. McKenna Hatcheski on third, Schulte on second, and Emma Eicher again on first after getting hit. We'll see how many times she can get hit today, as I believe we're going to have a pitching change here on the mound. Braylon Brown, just a tough outing today, and it, you know, just happens to everybody here and there. So now pitching on the mound will be Jalen Elias, as I make the correct substitutions on my scorecard. And we're going to take a short break as Elias is going to warm up on the mound. We'll be back here in just a moment on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
Building a first bank in South Dakota was the easy part, earning the confidence of local farmers, helping families account for their dreams, and securing the future for countless businesses. Took us a little longer. We owe it to the hard workers, big dreamers, and forward thinkers out there. Thank you for making South Dakota a great place to call home.
Choose Floortech Cleaning and Restoration, locally owned by Tom and Nancy Langdon since 1994, and because they offer so many services for residential and commercial properties, like carpet cleaning, mold testing and removal, fire and smoke damage, and duct cleaning. Floortech Cleaning and Restoration also offers emergency services in Yankton, Mitchell, Southeast South Dakota, Northeast Nebraska, and Norfolk.
Whether a broken pipe or flooding rain, when your home or floor is wet, call Floortech.
Located at 220 East 3rd Street in Yankton.
As we return, just missed the first pitch of the at-bat for Cameron Koletsky. It was taken for a ball. But that is the lone thing we missed again. It's Jalen Elias on the mound here for the Cobblers. Cameron Koletsky, her second at-bat. That one gets to the backstop. Runners are going to stay put, though. So bases remain loaded for Koletsky. And Koletsky, a very capable hitter here for the Gazelles. We'll see if she gets something good to put her bat on. And if she can put her team up more, it's now 6-0 on our Fox Stop scoreboard. Koletsky at the plate with Churchman deck. That pitch outside. Now a 3-0 count here between Elias and Koletsky.
You know, I think the intimidation of the batter is starting to get to the pitcher on the mound. When she was warming up, she was throwing some pretty good balls, strike zone, but someone standing there, it becomes a whole new game.
And it really does. Koletsky gets walked. She's standing on first. Make it 7-0 with Hatcheski headed home. Haley Schulte on third. On second is Emma Eicher. And it really is, especially in an away game, whole different thing from warm-up to pitching in person. Kyra Churchma at the plate. That first pitch low. Misses for a ball. 1-0 the count. Still that one out. That was actually the first batter in the bottom of the first was the first out when Eicher tried stealing second. But since then, every player has gotten on and are either currently on or have scored. 2-0 now the count as that one misses well outside. Churchma was walked earlier in the inning. She scored. Mosier on deck now. Herbolt in the hole. As Churchman got a piece of that one, it bounced off her leg, though, so that's going to be a dead ball. But a good sign for the Cobblers and for Elias, getting one across the plate cleanly, 2-1 here. As I know the score, it already looks like, okay, 7-0 after just one inning of play. This game, I mean, you've got 6 innings of play to make your comeback. You just got to calm down, get set up, re-obtain your composure. And I think the Cobblers can do that here, but the Gazelles look to keep adding on runs. If they have bases loaded, of course they're going to be gunning. But Churchma, 2-1 count, a line drive, grounder up the middle, a base hit, the first of the game. Gazelles score one, they're going to score two. And then trotting over to second will be Churchma. A base hit there for Kyra Churchma. She has the first of the game. It is a single, but she's technically on second now here. Iacher scored from second. Haley Schulte scored from third. Peyton Mosier at the plate has two runners on, 9-0 now.
Yeah, like you were saying, softball does come down to just a game of motivation. So, I mean, they are down now 9-0 in the first inning, but two or three innings come later, and it might as well just be the other way sometimes. And that's
no time limit really is what makes baseball and softball such a great sport. Is it doesn't matter. You're never truly out of it as that pitch hits the outside zone, 1-1 the count. But, you know, even if you're down, you know, say in a professional baseball game, 20-0, bottom of the ninth, yeah, is it unlikely? Yes. Do you have a chance, though? You do technically have a chance. And, of course, obviously this is nothing like that. As Mosier, a grounder over to first. She's going to try running it out, as she will. The error. Gazelles score their 10th run, and they score their 11th, taking off for second now is Mosier. As she reaches second, the throwing error, she'll head to third as she's standing on third safe.
Yeah, that one probably should have been a routine out there. Should have been the momentum switcher there.
And it really should have, yeah, you know, get that second out, then it's like, all right, we just need to get one more. But Herbolt now at the plate. She was walked earlier in the inning, scored. Takes a good cut at that one, doesn't get it. 0-1 the count. So 0-1 the count. 11-0 now the score with Yankton on top. As she dribbles that one, and it's picked up and over to first for the second out as Jalen Elias takes that one herself. Mosier stays on third. And that's really what they needed here. So Madison Girard still has a runner on, a chance to score at least one more here as she takes the first pitch off of the front of the plate. Mosier's going to stay on third. Kind of surprised to see. There was a lot of time to run there, but you never really know how it's going to bounce there. And, you know, she kind of made her decision, and she's maybe thinking, oh, crap, I could have ran. But what do you do at that point?
Yeah, that time it happened to take a lucky bounce, but maybe she took off that ball, decides not to, and just sits there, and that's third out.
So the next one also gets to the backstop, 2-0 now the count. As no swing from Girard. Girard was beaned earlier in the inning. She ended up scoring. Jocelyn Burns on deck with McKenna Hatchesky. Combined her first and her last name a little bit there. As happens, right? You know, happens to the best of us. 2-0 the count. As that one does hit the outside zone there. 2 balls, 1 strike here.
Yeah, it looked like Girard wanted to swing at that one, but called off at the last second.
So again, 2-1 the count. As Girard gets a good piece of that one into center field, as it's going to fall for another base hit here for the Gazelles. She's standing on first with an RBI single. Mosier's going to score the 12th run of the game here for the Gazelles.
Yeah, good thing she waited. Good thing she ate that strike.
Yep, and scored another run here for the Gazelles. Jocelyn Burns now batting. Has Girard on first. She got a good piece of that one. But it's going to be fouled off down the third baseline. As the Gazelles up, far and away the biggest lead they've had on the season yet. And the most runs they've put up on the season as well in a single game. As they're going to say, I guess Madison Girard took off a little too early from first, headed for second. She's going to be called out. That will retire the first inning of play. When we return the top of the second, leading off for the Cobblers will be Shayna Weir, followed by Jalen Elias and Haley Lang. As the Cobblers have some work to do here, but six innings of play to do so. We'll be back in a moment on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
Ryzen Healthcare in Yankton offers medical, dental, and behavioral health services for all, from tooth pains to aches and pains. Our new location on 920 Broadway Avenue is a comfortable, expanded space where everyone is welcome. Whether insured, uninsured, Medicaid, or Medicare, here in Yankton, we care for all, and that's what we care about most. Call to schedule your appointment at Horizon Healthcare.
As Shayna Weir steps to the plate, she leads off here for the Cobblers. On deck is Jalen Elias and Haley Lang in the hole. As that one, a line drive back to Hansen off her glove. She's able to pick it up and still get the throw in time. What a play by Hansen.
Just
on the
barely there. I thought she was going to be safe.
And that's, I was not making my call until I saw the official hold up his hand in a fist. Out number one, so four up, four down. Hansen, a good play on the mound, good reaction, as that one could have went a lot worse for the Gazelles, but Hansen doing a nice job on the mound. Another strike thrown, 0-1 the count, with Jalen Elias here now batting. So the first pitcher's duel of the game, as Hansen was not batting during that first inning for Yankton. That one hits the outside zone, 0-2 now the count, as Hansen trying to take the first two herself. Of course, with the help of Herbolt on first. Can't do it all on your own. As that one's fouled off the net. Count remains 0-2.
You almost got a foul ball there, Zach.
It's a good feeling because then everyone in the crowd is like, oh, wow, that was so impressive. And it's like, eh, you know.
we might just cut the commercial early to go chase that thing down.
Right. As that one's hit into shallow center field, never mind. It's going to just die. That wind killed it. Church McCaught it near second base. But I tell you what, Gage, I don't know. With that wind, that might make it out to center field.
Yeah, that ball is a perfectly hit ball if there's no wind.
I mean, that one just totally died. Elias really made solid contact. But Haley Lang at the plate now. No runners on. She faces two outs, fouled off the first pitch, 0-1 the count. But really, I mean, I think you take away the win, that's probably the first base hit of the game for the Cobblers. And
a darn good one.
Yeah, it would have been a nice line drive hit up the middle. Instead, Kyra Church may be able to get under it. As that one's now hit into right field, Haley Schulte tried making the diving grab, unable to. That will be the Cobblers' first base hit of the game. They're headed for third. The throw to third won't make it as the ball went out of play. I believe that should... Yep, that will advance Lang all the way home. So that is a triple for the Cobblers. Well, that's how you start a run here, Gage. You get one quick.
Yeah, like we were talking about earlier, things can turn around whenever, and you know, maybe this is the beginning of a comeback.
So Haley Lang hits a triple, ends up getting a... You know, I don't want to say in the park home run. She did go all the way from home to home, but it's technically a triple. But we'll let her, you know, that's an inside the park home run. She made it home to home as she scores the first run for the Cobblers. First base hit. Now Braylon Brown here at the plate. Started on the mound. Takes the first pitch, called for a strike. 0-1 the count.
Yeah, if I'm the batter, I'm calling that. I'm telling all my friends that was an inside the park home run.
Absolutely, and I think, you know, as that one's a grounder now picked up at short, Mosier's going to sail, or excuse me, Churchma's going to sail that one. Braylon Brown standing on first with an error, but yeah, I agree with you, Gage. But just like that, two hitters now. And one thing I want to point about Haley Lang is she was swinging the bat nicely, making good contact, and she's the sixth batter. You know, you wonder, looking awfully good at the plate. You know, maybe she's trying to move up in the batting lineup. Now it's Malia Saucerman batting here. She got a good piece of it, but Jocelyn Burns right there at second base, able to make the catch, as that was good contact from Saucerman, but Burns in good position as the top of the second inning. Cobblers got one of the runs back that they needed, as it's now 12-1 here, heading into the bottom of the second. Leading off when we return, Jocelyn Burns on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
Interior technicians.
I'm ready for my big role, Jerry.
What do you mean?
You said I'd be in your next 30 commercials.
No. I said InTech has over 30 years of commercial cleaning experience. You know, like offices, so they can ensure happy visitors and a healthy workforce.
So the shoot's in an office? I can make that work.
Oh my goodness. When you need it clean, call the InTech team.
Kaiser Heating and Cooling is your local source for heat and glow fireplaces, gas inserts, and wood stoves. Also home to the Trane HVAC systems, humidifiers, dehumidifiers, and mini splits. Whether building or remodeling, the team of experts will get you the right size of HVAC system for your home or business. The ductwork is made in-house, and then the installers will get your Trane system installed in no time to keep you cool in the summer and warm in the winter. Kaiser Heating and Cooling since 1948.
After 1.5 innings of play on our Fox Stop scoreboard, 12-1, Yankton Gazelles on top. Big here in this one after a big first inning. They look to add on to that lead here in the bottom of the second. Again, it's Jocelyn Burns leading off. McKenna Hatchiski on deck with Haley Schulte in the hole. We'll see if Yankton is able to bat around or if Rapid City Central has dialed in on defense. So still on the mound, it'll be Jalen Elias. So Burns at the plate. At first pitch, well high for ball one. Burns in the first inning was walked. As she gets a good piece of that one, scooped up at third. The throw at first does make it in time. As a nice grab at third there from Malia Saucerman. So one up, one down here. A little different start here for the Gazelles.
Yeah, it looks like Rapid City Central's starting to get that momentum that I was talking about earlier. And hopefully they can turn some things around and make this a competitive game.
As McKenna Hatchiski here, second at bat here of the game. Reached by error in the first. First pitch was well high for ball one. And as he said, you know, maybe Rapid City Central kind of shaking those early game nerves, trying to work back into it. But Yankton still holds a commanding 11-run lead. And they're hungry to get that win, Gage. Now 2-0 the count after the next pitch high as well. As the wind picks up a little here. In a red flag warning for Yankton.
Yeah, I swear every day I wake up, I check the weather, and South Dakota's always in some kind of weather warning.
As that pitch in for a strike, 2-1 now the count. And if that's not the truth, you're either in a winter weather advisory, a red flag warning, or you got 110 degrees in the middle of summer.
Yeah, heat, wind, rain, fire. Something's always happening.
As that one's lofted towards first base, scooped up by the second baseman. Nice play there as it got under Crandall's glove, but picked up there.
By number 12, it looks like.
That's Jalen Elias. As it's not Elias on the mound anymore. It's Cheyenne Dudley. So two up, two down here. McKenna Hatchiski grounds out. And again, a great play by Elias there at second. Haley Schulte at the plate on deck. Emma Iacker.
Looks like we have a new catcher, too.
And Madison Musfelt is actually going to be batting in place of Haley Schulte here for the Gazelles. And catching is Malia Saucerman, who I had at third. Good catch, Gage. As I try and figure out my lineup here. First pitch is called for strike one, 0-1 the count, as it looks like Cheyenne Dudley, who moved in from shortstop, making good work on the mound here. Dudley, that pitch hits the outside zone, now an 0-2 count that Madison Musfeldt faces. Cobblers would benefit greatly from a 3-up, 3-down inning here, as Musfeldt fouls that one right back. 0-2 still the count. As there's been a lot of substitutions here for the Cobblers in the field, trying to get them all.
Yeah, statistician's nightmare.
As that one's called for strike three, the first strikeout of the game for the Gazelles. Musfeldt goes down looking as Cheyenne Dudley and her team seem to have found a rhythm, but they still trail 12-1. They need to put some back here as an 11-run lead for the Gazelles entering the third inning. We'll be back in a moment on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
New year, new flooring. I plan on saying hello with new flooring from Larson Carpet in Yankton. Larson Carpet will help with design and installation. They have a great selection of carpet, vinyl, luxury vinyl plank, hardwood, and tile. Stop in and let them help you get a new look in the new year. Larson Carpet at 208 Walnut Street in the Meridian District in Yankton. For the best flooring for your space, lifestyle, and budget, see Larson Carpet.
Top of the third inning here at Sertoma Park. As Yankton got off to a hot start, they scored 12 in the first inning. The Cobblers put one back in the second inning. They're batting here in the third, but their defense looks like they have tightened up here as it was a 3-up, 3-down. Both teams, again, looking for that first victory of the season.
Like another substitution?
Yes, I'm trying to keep up here. Elena Nelson is going to head into second. You wonder. So she's in at second for Jocelyn Burns.
Jocelyn Burns looks like she went to third.
Jocelyn Burns at third. I'm trying here on the scorecard here, but we've had changes on both sides. And as he said, yeah, Burns now at third, as I believe that means Madison Gerard. Don't see her.
Yep, Madison Gerard is now out.
So Elena Nelson has come in for Gerard, but she'll take over second as that one's cracked hard into right center as it's going to land another base hit here for the Cobblers. Heading for second now as standing up with a double is Katie Crandall. As Rapid City Central still trying to build on that momentum.
It's 11-point game right now, but looks like the Cobblers finally found something.
And they have, so runner on second here now, top of the lineup for the Cobblers. Lily Larson, 0-for-1 today, batting again. As the umpire, I believe he's telling her, make sure to stay within on that front step. I know when I played, I loved taking a monster step, and it was probably detrimental to me, but I wanted home runs, and wonder if it's the same thing there. Lily Larson, though, no swing on the first pitch, a good eye from her. 1-0 the count. So now two base hits apiece for each team. Hansen's next pitch just misses outside. Lily Larson at the plate with Mary Kohlhoff on deck. Cheyenne Dudley in the hole. That pitch does hit the inside zone. 2-1 the count now. Hansen winds up, fires it. That one's fouled back. As I'm making sure it doesn't hit my car. It didn't.
Close.
I was getting a little worried there. It'll just be a foul ball with no broken glass. Two balls, one strike here. So Larson still at the plate here. She got a piece of that one, but right to Churchma at shortstop. The first out here in the top of the third belongs to Kyra Churchma. She's made a couple plays at shortstop, and I've kind of sang some praise for her on the season so far. There's a reason she's at shortstop. Churchma makes big plays regularly and definitely a good addition. Well, I say addition. She was here last year too. But a great part of this Gazelles defense. One out here, Mary Kuhlhoff at the plate. She got a piece of that one, a dribbler, but it's going to foul off down the third base side. And it's no longer Gerard at third. It's Jocelyn Burns. That's going to throw me off now, Gage, because Gerard's kind of been on third all season, and Burns, when she plays, is at second. So, Hanson, that one. That one's hit. Good into right field. It's drifting. Foul as a good sliding effort there from Haley Schulte, who's still playing the field. She just had Madison Musfeld bat for her. So 0-2 now the count, though. So Hanson still looking to put away the first by strikeout here in the game. She's had a strikeout in every game so far on the mound, as that one's fouled straight back as well. 0-2 the count remains.
Yeah, this Cobbler team's been taking really good cuts at the plate. Their batting has been impressive.
And that is true. They've taken some good swings, maybe not, you know, getting the placement that they'd like, but they are taking good swings and getting good contact. Another hard hit grounder scooped up. A good throw to first. No, as that'll be an error, as headed for second now. Kuhlhoff reaches off of the wild throw, an error at first. And Jocelyn Burns at third. It was a hard-hit grounder. Did a nice job picking it up. Just got to make sure to get set up. Take your time with that throw. I know, obviously, you can't take too much time as they're running for first. But you got to make sure, get set up. Make sure you're throwing right at them. Kuhlhoff on second after the error. Cheyenne Dudley at the plate. Shayna Weir on deck. Cobblers could bring in some more runs to start chipping away at that 11-run lead held by the Gazelles. Next pitch from Hanson. That hits the inside zone for a strike. So Hanson versus Dudley here. Now this is another pitcher's duel, as Dudley did take over that next pitch outside for a ball. Next one. That hits the outside zone for strike two. One ball, two strikes, one out. Runners on second and third here. It's Crandall on third. She hit the double. Kuhlhoff on second, who reached by error and then took off for second. A grounder that bounces off of Dudley. A dead ball here. Gazelle's trying to hang on to this lead, avoid giving up as many runs as possible. And they haven't given up any here in the top of the third, but Cobblers are threatening. We'll see the Gazelle's defense. As that one, a line drive hit into right field. It's going to be in and out and back into the glove for out number two, but the Cobblers will score. Haley Schulte was able to catch it. It popped out of the glove and catch it again.
Yeah, so they get another out, but they chop at that lead a little bit more. And what a catch. I thought she dropped that.
Well, you saw the bright yellow ball, as there's maybe confusion if Kuhlhoff had tagged up at second. Umpire's going to say Gazelles did go touch second. They're going to say she did. So now just a runner on third, but two outs here after the sacrifice fly from Dudley and Schulte. What a play there, as a line drive caught immediately. It was good contact, but snagged by Elena Nelson at second. She gets in. She makes a play right away as the Cobblers get within 10 runs here. They've scored a run in each of their last innings at the plate. We'll be back in a moment where Yankton I believe, at the top of their lineup when we return. And it is, leading off will be Emma Iacker.
Central Crossing, located at 1101 Broadway, Morgan Square in Yankton. Hi, it's Linda. Welcome to my store. The girls' department is sizes 2T to 14. The nursery holds Copper Pearl, Little Me Sleepers. The boys' department is 2T to 12. There's retro toys and little golden books. The ladies' department holds Tribal and Jag and Lulu B and jewelry and purses and your Yankton High School colors. Thank you for shopping Linda's Angel Crossing.
Heading into the bottom of the third inning here. Leading off again, it's Emma Iacker, her third at bat in the same amount of innings, as we do still have Cheyenne Dudley, at least, on the mound. I can make sure to say that one right, as I'm still trying to catch up with all the adjustments. It's hard as the game goes. They don't really always make the adjustments made known, as it looks like Emma Iacker not going to be batting here. Chase Drotzman will be batting for her, I believe. And it is Chase Drotzman. She'll get her first plate appearance here in the bottom of the third inning.
Man, you were behind on those substitutions, but now you're one step ahead.
And on deck, it will be Eliza Gurney rather than Cameron Koletsky. So some players getting some good at-bats here, varsity minutes. So Cheyenne Dudley, a line drive roped foul, though. Chase Drotzman making good contact with her first swing. 0-1 the count. And Cheyenne Dudley has been pretty consistent. She's put on the mound in the second inning, had a three up, three down to start. Right away throws a strike here in the bottom of the third, as just misses on that one outside. One ball, one strike here. ...12-2, Yankton still with the lead. That pitch also outside, an off-speed pitch from Dudley. As I try to get the numbers across the board. As Drotzman takes a cut, doesn't get it, 2-2 now. As Mary Kohlhoff is actually at shortstop now. She started behind the plate. So there's another addition there to the changes. As that pitch low, Chase Drotzman now fighting a full count here. 3-2, no outs, no runners on. She's the leadoff hitter here for the Gazelles in the bottom of the third. And really all I need here is who is at third base. As that pitch outside, Chase Drotzman heading to first with a walk. A leadoff base runner for Eliza Gurney and the Gazelles.
Looks like it's number two, or 20, I guess.
Well, we got number two at shortstop.
Okay, so probably number 20 would be my guess. I could be wrong.
Maybe a 21.
Yeah, you know, my eyes are pretty deceitful.
So Eliza Gurney, as I had said, Haley Schulte, the only lefty in the Gazelles lineup at that moment, I guess. Eliza Gurney will line up in the left-handed batter's box here. So Gurney, her first at-bat here of the season, takes a called strike one, 0-1 the count. Has a runner on first. As she fouls that one off, make it 0-2. Kyra
right.
Churchma on deck. I saw number 21. I'm like, oh, I don't have that. And I was like, wait a second. That's Churchma. She bats normally. So all these substitutions, I was getting a little mixed up who was batting, but it is Churchma on deck. Eliza Gurney at the plate. Chase Drotzman on first after the walk. As she got a piece of that one as well, fouls it out of play.
Yeah, that one's a little closer to your car.
Don't say that. So, count remains. No balls, two strikes here. No outs. Yankton trying to get back those two runs that they gave up to the Cobblers here. As that one low. No swing from Gurney. The first ball, though, in this at-bat. So 1-2 the count. Dudley winds up. Gurney, a good piece of that, a line drive, roped into left field, a base hit, and it's going to get by. So Chase Drotsman heading for third, Gurney on second. Drotsman's headed home. She's going to score an RBI double in Eliza Gurney's first at bat here of the season.
Split the gap. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Couldn't say it any better. Gage, that was a beautiful base hit there and a score run. A scored run for the Gazelles with Kyra Churchma here at the plate trying to replicate what she just saw Gurney do. As that pitch low, Gurney's headed for third. She slides, she'll be safe. So the ball thrown down to third. It looked like maybe still had some time, but Gurney able to get there. So Churchma gets a piece of that one straight back near the field directly behind us. Runner on third, one ball, one strike here, no outs. Churchma has a chance to put her team up 12 here. As on deck, Peyton Mosier. That pitch outside misses for a ball two. Dudley adjusting her glove, trying to get back on track. She's been pretty consistent on the mound so far today. As Churchma, hard hit grounder, picked up. The throw does make it in time for out two. Out number one. Yes. It's a good thing we have you here today, Gage. You've helped me correct a few things. Mosier at the plate now. So Peyton Mosier in this game, 0 for 1. She's walked, also reached by error. Herbolt on deck still. First pitch outside. No swing for Mosier. As Eliza Gurney still standing on third. And again, what a double she hit. What a nice hit that was. As that one fouled off out of play, that one will reach the field behind us.
Made it to the outfield.
There you go. 1-1 is the count. One out, one runner on. Mosier looking for her first base hit here of the game. She has a couple on the season. That pitch well low in the dirt. Two balls, one strike here. Dudley and the Cobblers. They've given up one run here in the bottom of the third. Trying to avoid any more than that. That pitch low gets to the backstop. Gurney stays on third though. 3-1 now the count. Three balls, one strike. As Mosier, a hard hit grounder over to third. As the ball bounced in error, Mosier will reach first. A good play to scoop it up, but the throw didn't quite make it. Bounces off, and Crandall unable to scoop that one up. So Emma Herbolt batting on deck. Well, we'll see. We'll see who's on deck. It's Elena Nelson on deck. And that is the same as the substitution we had in for Madison Gerard. That is where she was. So we know we got that one. Herbolt at the plate. That pitch gets to the backstop. Heading for second is Mosier. Runners now on second and third. Dudley. That one. Also low, getting to the backstop. 2-0 the count. As you know, Rapid City Central, the last thing they want to see is any walks here. As that's kind of what was the result of that first inning. Those 12 runs was a lot of walks. That one low as well. 3-0 now the count for Herbolt.
Yeah, walks will kill you there. Yeah, hopefully they avoid it here and they get something rolling, get the second out. But just need to calm down. Once you throw one or two bad pitches, you kind of get flustered. And
that's exactly it. And Herbolt headed to first with the walk. Bases now loaded with one out only, as Elena Nelson will take her first at bat here of the game. And I believe also her first of the season. Maybe her and Eliza Gurney can both start off their hitting for the year with doubles. Takes the first pitch there. Dudley's got a strike. That's really what the Cobblers just need. Calm down, throw some strikes. Even if the ball's put in play, we've seen their defense make some plays here. That pitch well high. Count now knotted up at 1-1.
Yeah, if I'm Rapid City, you need a strikeout here. Stay in this. Get out of the pickle. This is a big strikeout at bat.
Because you've
get things under control.
You've scored those two runs in the last two at bats, but you've given up one here, and it's going to feel almost for nothing as that one gets the backstop. Gazelles all stay. 2-1 now the count. We'll see, though. Yankton with a few base hits in this game. Next pitch from Dudley, as that one is a soft hit one right back to Dudley. No chance at home, really, for Gurney. She thought maybe it was going to get caught, so she really kind of hesitated. And that's when you're probably not running out. So Gurney out at home for out number two. All the runners will advance. Mosier to third, Herbold at second, Elena Nelson on first by fielder's choice, and Jocelyn Burns batting here for the Gazelles. Base is loaded still, but two outs this time. Lofts it into left field as a great catch made out in left field. That one by Shayna Weir, barring any substitutions. But a nice grab as she had to extend her arm. We head into the top of the fourth inning in an 11-run game. Yankton on top. When we return, leading off for the Cobblers, Jalen Elias in a moment.
If you've fallen behind on your do-it-yourself projects at home and don't know where to start, Mead Lumber is your answer. Mead Lumber is your local stop for all things home improvement, from cabinetry to roofing. We have what you need for your next project. For over 100 years, Mead Lumber has been assisting customers with their home improvement needs, as well as assisting professional contractors, builders, and remodelers. The knowledgeable staff at Mead Lumber of Yankton will help you finish all your projects. Located at 2409 North Broadway, stop in today to see how Mead Lumber can help you.
Insurance Agency values family. Our agency has been family-run for over 60 years. We pride ourselves on excellent, knowledgeable customer service. This day and age, everyone is so eager to have an immediate response with a quote. But at Midwest Insurance, we take our time and evaluate your assets and make sure you are properly insured. We take those what-ifs very seriously. As we continue on our family business with hopes of our children, Brooke or Jet, taking over in the future, we will continue to be there for you always. Come be a part of our family. Midwest Insurance Agency, 3016 Piper Street, Yankton.
And we do have a pitching change here for the Gazelles. As Muth said, it's going to be Hansen and Gerard, so you can probably take a crack at who it is on the mound. Madison Gerard now warming up. Looks to have a little zip on her throw here, as last time she came in for Brandon Valley, did a pretty nice job. So, kind of listening in on what the umpire's saying. So Madison Gerard on the mound. Iacker and Cameron Kletsky, they didn't bat, but they will be fielding here. So those are the substitutions, but kind of ones we expected were going to be in place anyways. But again, Gerard on the mound as leading off here. As Jalen Elias, Haley Lang on deck, and Braylon Brown in the hole. First pitch from Gerard in for a strike. So 0-1 the count from Gerard. Next pitch in the dirt. We're in the turf, I should say. One ball, one strike here. Elias, 0-1 today, trying to get a base hit. Be a leadoff runner for her team. Takes the next pitch, also for ball. 2-1 now the count. As we haven't seen much from Gerard on the mound. It's been mostly Hansen so far for the Gazelles. But a dribbler picked up here by Mosier. The throw to first gets there. And one up, one down here. Good start on the mound for Madison Gerard. That'll bring up Haley Lang on deck, Braylon Brown. Haley Lang, 1-for-1 today, hit that triple to right field earlier in the game. And she was one that I had mentioned, took really nice cuts at the ball and looked like somebody I don't really want to pitch to.
No, she eats that first strike, but I'm expecting a hit still.
So 0-1, they'll start with Gerard. Hit the outside zone, a very nice pitch. The next one, as a grounder hard hit to third, picked up the throw. It's a good one, two up, two down, as Yankton's defense playing well here. And again, at third, it is Jocelyn Burns. And as we had said, that last time she made that throw was a little soft, and that's where we had that error. Great throw there from Jocelyn that time. So Braylon Brown at the plate on deck. Malia Saucerman, that pitch well low. As a former catcher, I got to point out, though, Mosier doing a great job blocking it, keeping it in front of her.
That's what you got to do. Any ball passed to is a bad one.
So Gerard, the next pitch, just barely misses. 2-0 now the count, but two outs here. No runners on for the Cobblers. Yankton's defense has made a couple of nice plays here. That pitch high, so a 3-0 count. Braylon Brown, we wonder if she has the green or red light. Next pitch. Misses low, so a runner here in the top of the fourth for the Cobblers. Walked was Braylon Brown. So Saucerman, 0-for-1 in this game. She was another one who had a good cut at it. Takes the first pitch, a called strike, 0-1. Winds up the next one, low. That one gets by Mosier, and taking off her second is Brown. That's a tricky one, especially on this turf field, as it hit well in front of home plate. So you're really going to see a lot of bounce there.
Yeah, I mean, playing on our natural fields, you never know what the hop is going to be. But I only expect on turf, you never really know what the hop is going to be because it's going to be so much higher. You're never really ready for it.
And that is, you know, switching from turf to regular, as Coach Rodner talked about for Rapid City Central. He said, got to get them prepared as they're not used to it. A nice line drive hit. That's going to be off the glove at second into the outfield. Another scored run here for the Cobblers, as that one I'm crediting with a base hit. Saucerman got a good piece of that one. Not really a great chance unless Elena Nelson really made kind of a diving effort at it. So that's, I'm counting as a base hit. So now three straight at innings where the Cobblers have scored a run. Their batting has been pretty solid here. And again, if it wasn't for that first inning, they'd be right in this one. First pitch from Gerard against Katie Crandall, a strike. Crandall's 1-for-1, hit a double in the third inning. She was also the one that scored in that inning. Next pitch is low, ball one. So one ball, one strike, two outs here. We'll see if it follows suit with the last three innings as it's hit up and caught. Running all the way over, Elena Nelson. Nelson doing a very nice job. We haven't seen too much of her this season, but she's really kind of impressed in the field. So we'll see in our chat with Jill Muth, maybe, you know, see if she might be someone we're seeing more of later into the season. But now, after scoring one run, Cobblers still within 10 here, heading into the bottom of the fourth inning. We'll be back and leading off McKenna Hatchesky in a moment on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
Riverfront and Brewery Event Centers and Hotels Yankton has choices for a bride and groom and your wedding reception. Different spaces are available for your wedding reception and the price is very competitive. Have your wedding reception where they offer you plenty of time for the decorating you and your family want to do and plenty of time for cleanup too. At the Riverfront and Brewery Event Centers and Hotels, you have 2.5-day venue that's all yours. See more by cruising the website Riverfront and Brewery Event Centers and Hotels.
You deserve to get good service and great rates. At State Farm, we get it, and we're here to help. Because with every State Farm policy, you get good neighbor service and surprisingly great rates. So what are you waiting for? Get going and talk to a local State Farm agent about your surprisingly great rates today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Individual premiums will vary by customer. All applicants subject to State Farm underwriting requirements. When you want the real deal, call State Farm agent Roy Wilcox in Yankton today.
Bottom of the fourth inning here, Yankton Gazelles on top, still hanging on to a double-digit lead. They led 12-0 after one. It's 13-3 here as they did score a run last inning. It was Chase Drotzman after getting walked as the leadoff batter. She made it all the way around. So McKenna Hatchesky here, her second at-bat of the game on deck. Haley Schulte will be batting again. So Hatchesky awaits the first pitch. That one's high for a ball. As I would hate to hit into left field right now. It's not going anywhere if you do. Hatchesky takes the next pitch. That one's also high for ball two.
Oh, yeah, that wind's blowing it right back to the third baseman.
I mean, you know, your best bet would maybe be that it blows it far enough forward that the left fielder is just sprinting at it and can't keep up with it, really. But either way, a 2-0 count here. Hatchesky at the plate. That pitch does hit the outside zone. Two balls, one strike here. Gazelles want a leadoff runner. They want to keep up with that pace of the Cobblers, at least keep up with the runs they have scored here. They've scored one in each of their last three at-bats here. That one misses outside. 3-1 the count. So Hatchesky has a pitch to be picky. And the pitch off the 3-1 count as Hatchesky, a grounder, picked up at third. What a play, but dropped at first. That'll be an error. Hatchesky standing on first. And now at third, Haley Lang finally got that number. It's Haley Lang at third. Really an impressive play, kind of the jump throw. It looked like I was watching Tavares Jackson highlights, if for any Minnesota Viking fans out there. Haley Schulte, her second at bat of the day. A grounder, also over to third. The pickup at shortstop. They'll get the lead runner as Hatchesky's out at second. And Schulte will be on first with a fielder's choice. And Emma Iacher will bat again now after she was out for Chase Drotzman. But Iacher to bat here for her fourth time now in the game. Iacher fouls that one straight back, 0-1 the count. And I do want to give kudos to Cheyenne Dudley on the mound. Was kind of put into a not-so-great situation, but she's done a fantastic job so far. Through 2 1/3 innings, she's given up one run, one base hit, and her defense has had one error in that time.
Yeah, for the situation she's been put in, she's really fighting tooth and nail to get them back in it.
She is. She's been accurate for the most part. We do have a walk or two, but for the most part, she's forced the Gazelles to put the ball in play. So 2-0 now the count. Eicher got a good piece of that one. Trying to take out her coach at third base. As Jill probably glad she's standing at first right now. 2-1 the count. As Eicher got a good piece of that one, roped down foul though. That'd have been a good, nice line drive. Doesn't matter what the wind was doing, that one was hit well, but it's going to be foul. Two balls, two strikes here. Still one out, one runner on first. As that last gust. I shouldn't have said no matter the wind, I guess.
Yeah.
That meant it was going to pick right up.
You made something really angry.
So Eicher, 2-2 the count. Cheyenne Dudley on the mound for the Cobblers. Dudley, that pitch high. Looked like an off-speed pitch. Kind of got away from her. Count now full for Eicher. Eicher, in her two at-bats in the game, has been hit by the pitch twice. She was swapped out for Chase Drotzman there in the third inning. Back in here for her third at-bat. So that one's low. She gets hit, too. You know, that's one she's maybe hoping doesn't hit her and she just takes the walk. But runners on first and second. As I'm not even sure if I count that as a walk or a bean. I think it's got to be a bean because it did hit her. So three times, and I mentioned, we'll see how many times she gets hit in this game as Cameron Koletsky now bats again.
Yeah, I don't really think they keep getting hit in the record books, but we might have to add a category if it keeps up.
As Koletsky got a piece of that one, fouls it out of play. Three times in one game, Chase. I never had that in my playing career. Twice, yes. Three, no.
Well, even twice. You must have really angered that pitcher before the game.
So Koletsky takes the next pitch high. Yeah, I got hit in the head, the helmet, the first one, and then that bone right above your elbow.
The funny bone?
No, I don't know if that's the funny bone. It's right above it, though. It about brought me to tears. But I don't see any tears from Eicher on first after her third. So yeah. That pitch making it past the back to the backstop. Both runners advance. Now on third is Haley Schulte. On second, Eicher. Koletsky took that for a called ball two as it was in the dirt. 2-1. Koletsky, a base hit, could score two here. As that pitch also low to the backstop. Runners stay, though. It makes it a little bit more difficult to steal on a pass ball if you're standing on third, as they don't have too much distance to make up. This backstop here is not very far back. It's always risky. And up 13-3, really not worth the risk. But 3-1 the count for Koletsky, as she's going to get a nice piece of it into right field. That's a base hit for Koletsky. She's going to score both her teammates, as it's 15-3 now. Eicher scores from second. From third, Schulte scores. Cameron Koletsky's got another base hit on the season. So we have another sub here. It's Haley Bottleson will be batting in place of Kyra Churchma. Mosier is on deck as of now, but 15-3 the score. Gazelles have got their bats rolling a little bit more than they have all season here. I've got them down for four. So Haley Bottleson for the first time of the year at the plate. On first is Koletsky with her single. As I'm trying to take note, I like to kind of keep stats for batting averages and everything. As taking off for second, Koletsky, as that one got by. Got by Saucerman behind the plate. So 1-0 the count here. Bottleson, no swing. Has a runner in second. That pitch also low, ball two. Thank you. Two balls, no strikes, one out here. Koletsky on second for the Gazelles. They've put up two runs here in this inning. That one low. Koletsky's headed for third. She'll reach with ease here. Three balls, no strikes. Bottleson, her first at-bat of the year. Looking like she'll get on base. Of course, we'll see.
Any contact to the ball gets her an RBI, so.
Pretty much, as Dudley does find the strike zone there. 3-1 now the count. As that's one thing I will say, Dudley on the mound, even when she gets down 3-0, she usually is able to find the zone right away. Trying to work her team out of the pinch here. As Bottleson got a piece of that one, fouled it out of play. Count now full. As you know, we're seeing some batters who haven't gotten a chance at the plate for the Gazelles actually looking pretty good. You know, you never, they're kind of the wild cards. You never know what you're going to expect. I haven't seen them bat all season. And we saw Eliza Gurney start off with a double as a grounder up the middle. And that's going to be a base hit for Bottleson. Koletsky scores. So Haley Bottleson starts the season 1-4-1. She's batting 1,000.
With an RBI.
And with an RBI. So Peyton Mosier here at the plate. All right, Peyton, you got it. Let's go, Mosier. I love this cookie. Mosier has reached base every time, but technically 0 for 2. Reached twice off of errors and once off a walk. That one got by. Bottleson's taking off for second. Here in the bottom of the fourth inning. And Gazelle's up 13. Now, the official rule is it's over if they get up to 15. Mosier would be the game-winning run at the plate. That one also gets by. Bottleson now on third. Mosier, no swing. Counts 2-0. Cobbler's trying to keep this game going. That one's ball three. Mosier, no swing. So 3-0 count, has a runner on third. One out here for Yankton. As Mosier takes off for first, she's walked. Emma Herbolt. She's been walked twice in the game. Also grounded out, so she's 0 for 1. Runners on first and third. We'll see how Muth and her team approach the 1-3 situation. As taking off for second is Mosier. Really no contest there. So runners on second and third. First pitch was low for a ball against Herbolt. As does... Trying to make sure I have the lineup correct. That one low, but scooped up by Saucerman, forcing Bottleson back to third. 2-0 now the count. As Madison Gerard will be batting on deck here. Herbolt still at the plate. Got a piece of that one sky high out of here. That's out of play. Another one where you wonder with the wind where that one really truly ends up. So a 2-1 count. Herbolt got a piece of that one. Dead ball as I believe it bounced off the plate, it sounded like. That or just a foul ball. Either or, 2-2. And got to wonder, that one, that first one that Herbolt did swing at probably was going to be high and outside. Could have been a 3-0 count or 3-1 now, but 2-2.
Yeah, big game changer, but.
And I think that sometimes she's been walked twice. I think she's kind of chomping at the bit to get a base hit, as that one is going to get by her. Now the count full. A walk would load the bases here for the Gazelles.
Yeah, when your team puts up 16 runs and you're 0 for 1, you got to kind of, you start thinking in your head, man, I should really have a hit by now. So,
and that's
a little bit of anxiousness to get one. And
that's the thing. There hasn't been a ton of base hits, but Herbolt is going to reach on error as Gazelles are going to score twice. And I do believe that's going to wrap up this game, Gage. So Herbal with the walk-off, reaching by error. That is going to wrap up the game, 18-3. The Yankton Gazelles with their first win of the season. After four innings of play, they win 18-3 over Rapid City Central. Now we await. The teams are going to line up, shake hands, and we are going to wait for Jill Muth. And it's always great to talk to a coach after a win like this. We'll be back in a moment here on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube.
Are you looking for your next great career opportunity? Then make it Sherco. A staple of the Yankton community, Sherco offers career opportunities in engineering, sales, marketing, accounting, tarp, metal fabrication, shipping, and assembly. Enjoy a year-round climate-controlled facility, 401k options, affordable health, dental, and vision care, paid time off, and 10 paid holidays. Make Sherco your next great opportunity. Learn more at sherco.com/careers.
Visit our sleep experts at the Yankton Slumberland. With over 50 mattresses to choose from, we carry every price, free financing options, and the most trusted brands in the nation like Stearns & Foster, Sealy, and Tempur-Pedic. Snoring or lower back pain tormenting you? Seek relief with an adjustable power base. Fall asleep faster and cooler with our sheets and pillow selection. With a 120-night sleep trial, you can't make a mistake. See us today at the Yankton Slumberland, 2401 Broadway.
Doctors Lane and Reed Sawatsky make up the team at SWAT Chiropractic and Rehab. Located at 800 Mariner Lane on the way out to the lake, we combine chiropractic with soft tissue treatments and rehabilitative exercise to custom tailor each individual patient experience. From sports injuries to sciatic nerve pain, we are here to help you move better and get back to doing what you love. SWAT Chiropractic, specialized wellness and therapy.
Looking for your first home? How about your next home? Maybe a vacation home. The Move Group is a full-service real estate brokerage operating in South Dakota, primarily servicing the Yankton and Sioux Falls, South Dakota areas. Having the knowledge and the drive to help you make the right purchase to suit you and your needs. When buying or selling a home, Mason at the Move Group is ready to get you the results you are looking for. Call us today. We're ready to work for you. Make the move with the Move Group.
Hi, this is Clay
and Rachel
from the Red Hydrant Inn and Playground in Yankton.
We offer daycare, boarding, grooming, and training for all breeds of dogs.
We are the one-stop shop for all dog necessities, treats, toys, collars, leashes, and more.
Your dog is family, and we treat them like our own.
Give us a call at 665-7297 or stop in 2901 Broadway in Yankton. We can't wait to meet you and your pet. Again, 665-7297.
You deserve to get good service and great rates. At State Farm, we get it, and we're here to help. Because with every State Farm policy, you get good neighbor service and surprisingly great rates. So what are you waiting for? Get going and talk to a local State Farm agent about your surprisingly great rates today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Individual premiums will vary by customer. All applicants subject to State Farm underwriting requirements. When you want the real deal, call State Farm agent Roy Wilcox in Yankton today.
Make it a double. No, make it a triple. Triple Time Rudy's in Yankton. Stop for premium, ethanol, or regular gas anytime with pay at the pump. Or stop in during regular hours to find the meats, cheeses, beverages, snacks to fuel you up. There's oil, grease, and more for your vehicles, gift cards, an unbeatable staff, and just the right amount of that personal service. Make it a Triple Time Rudy's, corner of 17th and Broadway, Yankton.
Again in the final, the Yankton Gazelles with their first win of the season. They win by 15 after four innings. 18-3 the final score, with Yankton on top of Rapid City Central. Engage, well, you got to be a part of the Gazelles' first win this year.
Yeah, and it looked a lot better than last night. They got the bats rolling. They still made some errors, but they weren't as bad, and everything looked good.
And it did look like Yankton kind of cleaned up some of that fielding, as we saw Jocelyn Burns an immediate impact on third. I mean, the first throw we saw was low and it was an error, but right after, I mean, immediately she was able to bounce back. Boom, next throw was on target.
Yeah, she noticed the problem and made the adjustment. And I mean, gave him an out. Making two errors back-to-back kind of hurts your team, and she realized the problem. So it's good that she fixed it and helped her team to the win.
So we did, and again, we saw some new players that we haven't really seen in the field or at the plate, really, for either teams. But Yankton, with a lot of rotation there, and you do have a little bit more freedom when you're up, you know, 10 runs or so. But Yankton, again, with their first win, they don't have much time to prepare for their next game, as they have two tomorrow, actually. Not just one. Tomorrow, their first game is at noon as well. So not really much time even at all from now to then. They have less than 24 hours. Less than 20. They take on Spearfish at noon tomorrow. It's at Yankton here in Sertoma Park. We'll be here on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube covering it. So join me tomorrow as, you know, kind of maybe a trickier game to get to as it's middle of the day, but works out a little better with Spearfish heading over from West River. But that game's at noon. We'll be live with it on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube, as well as their second game of the day, also in Yankton at Sertoma Park. They take on Pier TF Riggs. So two games tomorrow. First one is noon against Spearfish. Second one at 4 against Pier TF Riggs. And again, both at Sertoma Park, as we'll be here on 5-Star Streaming on YouTube. And joining me right now is head coach Jill Muth. And, well, Jill, there we go. We just talked about it, getting the first one, and that's exactly what we needed.
Yep, absolutely. That was our goal today, was get ourselves in the win column, which we did. And now with that monkey's off our back, now we can just go play.
Absolutely, and not much turnaround, as I was just talking about, tomorrow at noon, so you don't really have any time to think about it, really.
Nope, not a whole lot. I told this gal here sitting beside me, Tori, I said, well, we got three games in about 26-ish hours, maybe somewhere in that range, a little less than that. So I just, you know, trying to get everybody a little mixing it up here and giving everybody an at-bat, and that's kind of fun, getting everybody a chance to get an at-bat. How about Eliza Gurney getting her first varsity hit? That was kind of fun for her to see her smoke that ball out in there in the left center. So that was a good game for us tonight to get our first win, and a good opportunity to get everybody an at-bat, and keep rolling tomorrow, hopefully.
Absolutely, and as you said, I mean, if there was multiple players, and I was sitting here crossing out both sides with substitutions, I was trying to keep up on the scorecard. Wasn't quite so easy, but luckily I think I was able to figure everything out. But Eliza Gurney opens up with a double, and as you said, her first varsity hit. And then Haley Bottleson also got in with a base hit right up the middle. I mean, the hitting did look like, it looks like that practice that you had definitely helped out, Jill.
I'm sure that's what it was, don't you think?
Yeah.
Yep, yesterday getting the pitching machine out, I'm sure everybody's ready to roll now. We're going to start hitting about 400 as a team, I'm thinking.
All right, that's good to hear. And sitting beside you, you've got Tori Hansen. And Tori, you've kind of manned the mound. I know, kind of an odd way of maybe saying that. But Jill has clearly shown some trust in you. Today you absolutely delivered, pitching a lot of strikes and forcing them to put the ball in play. And also, I want to point out one play. There was the line drive right back at the middle at you. It was off your glove, and you could have given up and just been like, okay, I'll go jog and grab it. You picked it up. You were able to make the throw in time. What was kind of going through your mind or going through your head at that time?
I just thought we needed to get the out, and working to get the ball and throw it over to first to get the out so we could go to bat.
And that's exactly what happened. It was a great play. You impressed us. And I should count up how many walks. I don't even know if there was a single one in the fourth inning. And I don't believe that would have been Gerard, correct? So no walks for the entire game for you, Tori. That's a very great game.
Mm-hmm.
So, and looking forward to it tomorrow. I'm not sure. We don't have the starting lineup, but do you enjoy having, you know, like three games within 20, what did Jill say, 26 hours or
yeah.
so of each other?
Just got to ice my arm and make sure I'm ready, but I think I'll be good.
How many innings do you think you could pitch in a row, though? If you were absolutely needed to, how many innings do you think you could throw in a row?
I have no idea. Probably
57.
Yeah, 57.
57. Wow, that would be quite the feat. Well, hopefully we don't have a game going 57 innings. I love softball, but I don't know if I'm 57 innings straight or not. But, Tori, great job on the mound today. It's been a joy to kind of see. I mean, it looks like there's already improvement from game one to now. You're looking comfortable on the mound, and fantastic game. Congrats on the win.
Hey, thank you.
All right. Again, that was head coach Jill Muth of the Gazelles, as well as Tori Hansen, again, who was on the mound for the Gazelles, had a very good game today, and it was just a lot of smiles here. You see Gage as the Gazelles came away with the first win.
Yeah, it's a good feeling. So hopefully you can keep this momentum rolling and just keep on going.
And again, tomorrow they'll play at noon. It's against Spearfish at noon. And then they play Pier TF Riggs at 4. We'll be live with both those games on 5-Star streaming roughly 30 minutes or so before the first pitch. So games you're not going to want to miss. We'll see if the Gazelles can go on a win streak. Again, I'm Zach Spear alongside Gage Ravelet on 5-Star streaming. You're home for Yankton Gazelles softball. It's a windy day, but we'll see you tomorrow. Have a great rest of your night.